next is Josh. Josh has recently moved to the Kitchener-Waterloo area from Chatham, and tonight he's talking about designing leaky abstraction.
Alright, thank you. Hi everyone. First time speaking here. So we'll get started with a bit of a design and architecture talk. I called it Designing Leaky Abstractions. Leaky Abstractions is a term that people know because of Joel Smolsky. I'll get to that slide in a second. There's my picture and my Twitter handle, email, blog, and a bunch of names that people call me while I'm working. Some of it is because I can do them. Some of them is because I have done them. Hopefully the picture looks good and professionally done. It works out, people recognize me. So to get into what I mean by leaky abstraction, I'll just go with like the term as it's known today. I am gonna take a bend from here. So font is insanely small on this, so I apologize now. Now that I got on the screen, the errors are starting to become a bit obvious. So the term was popularized by Joel Smolsky. Everybody knows this guy from Joel on Software. He's Stack Overflow fame. He has lots of great points about optimal working situations and testing and all kinds of great opinions. I don't agree with all of them, but he's out there. So the term was originally coined by somebody who works at the University of British Columbia, and it is a law because it's so simple that it's hard to disagree with. The law of leaky abstraction says that all non-trivial abstractions leak. So what does that mean? What is a leaky abstraction now that we've kind of talked about the concept? So I'll go at it by means of example. The one that you can find everywhere is TCP/IP. TCP itself is a protocol that gives us the illusion of reliability across a fallible network. How does it do that? It uses a tiny little protocol called IP, which is effectively UDP and all the rest of them, and fires it down the network. And most of the time it doesn't work. It fails. So there's a small layer on top of IP, and it mimics reliability. So TCP is the abstraction, and most of the time we're blissfully unaware of packets failing, coming in the wrong order, coming in being mangled from intermediaries, all kinds of weird and uncomfortable things that go along with IP. When it leaks poorly, and that's the case with abstraction. You can't hide disconnect. When a connection is reset by a host, you see that one, and it's TCP complaining about how it just can't reach the other host. That's the leak. It's almost always about errors. So that brings us to my point about the current definition of leaky abstractions is that it's almost always about error management. The error management cross-cutting concern. How do you handle that error? What's it look like to the user? How does it leak? It always leaks in the form of an error. So I'm gonna bend that a little bit and talk about how an abstraction can leak, but leak functionally, not in the way of an error. So in the case of TCP, it's gonna drop a connection and you're gonna know it, and well, there's nothing you can do about it. But what happens when the leak is functional in that you can rely on the abstraction, it works, but no one can see its problem, except for us developers who get to see all the mess underneath the hood. So the place where it tends to get out of hand or it starts to break is around data types. And this is where it leaks, but it's also where the solution is. So, in keeping with my subtitle, here's a slice of a application. Usually there's a noun that goes on top of here that's like the order or the customer or the, and so there would be multiple stacks, which I didn't represent, but you know, it's repetitive, so I thought it would be a good programmer and factor it out for you. This is the leak then that I'm going at that is not the error type. So a leaky system is a missing layer of translation between functional layers. So this is actually the example of a leak. You can usually almost always tell that it's leaking in that your ORM models end up in the UI layer. And if you end up with that, you can do things that you shouldn't be able to do in the UI layer. So, the fix. There's already one fix in the previous slide. That's tables to ORM. And I've marked a new layer in here. I've called it contract. You don't see it very often. A lot of the time where you see the namespace contract, it's with well-designed WCF code. If anybody has background there, maybe yes, maybe no. It's kind of aging now. So what I'm going at here is kind of MDDM, where you translate into different types for different uses. In this case, if anybody has this amount of history, except for me, you would find ADO types in your repository. So you'd be firing commands into the database. There would be straight SQL in your code. And then you'd be passing around a data table or a, what was the other one? Anybody else remember the
data grid?
There was data grid, but that was the UI piece. It was the data reader. Data reader is the one that I'm looking at. In that case, you would have all this ADO stuff that would end up bleeding right to the form. You'd find SQL right at the form, right in the handler for a button click, which is gross code, friends. It's gross. So anyway, so what's the fix here? The fix is at the database level, it's translating out of database code and into an object model. So if anybody else is into Genfor or Martin Fowler, patterns, we're looking at the repository pattern to translate out. You can do triple D here, no judgment. Totally cool about either one of those drives. And then working with it, you know, in the logical layer, I call that a manager or an engine. I'm working with name conventions here. And then once you translate out of the manager and engine, you're going to come up with a new data type that you're going to admit to your controller in the form so that namespaces and assemblies that you would have used for database don't leak into the UI, because then your developers can do yucky things like writing SQL into a form handler. Oh wow, that's way too small. Okay, I'm going to have to talk through this slide because no one can read that. That's produced by the ORM, because theoretically we're using EF6 here. It's good. And then we would map out and return it to the order contract, and this goes back to this namespace. So when you go to pass it back to the controller, there's nothing left over from these layers, and there's nothing you can do in the UI that would be code naughty. What you end up with is nice clean code. There are other ways to do this, and I think we all know about it, but in this context, it might be a surprise. This contract ends up being serializable, and the controller in the form ends up being Angular. It ends up being JavaScript. You go through an entirely different tool set in order to clean up any possibility of this stuff leaking into your UI code. And that's kind of the pattern that most people deal with today. It is a guarantee because you can't even address that code from a different tool stack. And that's it for me. I might have been under on the time, but however, questions, comments? Was too terse? Too easy? Fired at me.
Was this before? Sorry, I missed the first part. Did you say that this came from a working solution that you had somewhere else? Or?
Multiple working solutions. This is typically how I lay down software. Depending on what the solution happens to be, whether it has a service boundary or not, how much time do you have, what does the business demand in the way of call records, logging, instrumentation, error handling, all of those kind of cross-cutting concerns and non-functional kind of things is how I rate code.
So when initially this, you mentioned the beginning, when the concept was introduced, in what context, or there were like big projects that required this abstraction or?
Abstraction in general. So in the way of money is an abstraction of value, right? I'm talking about it from a software point of view. An abstraction like TCP is kind of what I'm after, is that you're creating a little bit of code that takes some part of a system, moves it away from your view, so you just say, give me a new class, new object in memory, and that's the level of abstraction that I'm on about.
But you mentioned, what's the name of the guy who introduced initially the...
Gregor Kizalis? Or Joel Spolsky.
Yeah.
Joel Spolsky. He went on to a couple of different examples. He talked about shipping Hollywood stars from one side of the country to another, and they end up getting tattoos and piercings and then not being suitable for Hollywood photos, so then you end up like abstracting them out of that situation so that you get a more reliable star. But the TCP one was the one that was obvious and most often used, so I thought I'd put it back down so that if anybody here was interested in picking that back up, it would be easy to find.
So he doesn't talk about specific software project that Joe, you said?
Yeah, Joel Spolsky.
Yeah. He makes no reference to a specific software project where he just takes this Hollywood paradigm and just develops on it, yeah?
Yeah, exactly. And I think he is looking to talk about general cases. It is about conceptual level. Like, mm-hmm. This is a very conceptual level talk. Like, we could be talking about Java, C#, Python. Name your poison, and you can lay this into it. Syntax and style is going to modify how it looks, but for the sake of like software patterns, this could be done anywhere. It's just an easy way to throw together a new project. Someone's giving you the green field. Get open your favorite code editor. Go. So, yeah. Anything else?
Thank you.